This is the Bahamas, a culture like nowhere else on Earth, bursting with color and natural beauty that's hard to beat. Okay, I'm a little bit biased, but this is my home.
My name is Krista Sherman. I'm a science and conservation officer with the Bahamas National Trust, and I've been diving here all my life.
Many people come here for our beaches.
But if you really want to see the Bahamas at its best, you're gonna have to get wet.
Under the water lies one of the largest barrier reefs in the world. The archipelago stretches for nearly 1,000 miles. There's more coral reef here than anywhere else in the Caribbean.
But many of our reefs are now in danger because of things like climate change, overfishing, and pollution.
I wanted to see how widespread the problem is by surveying places I'd never dived before. So recently, I joined a very special scientific expedition. Working off Great Enaguas in the southern Bahamas. I was part of a team of scientists assembled by the Khalid bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation.
Just over a decade ago, His Royal Highness Prince Khalid bin Sultan established the Living Oceans Foundation to try to bring people from around the world together to work in harmony to combat this coral reef crisis that we're seeing unfold in front of us.
This last decade, the Living Ocean Foundation has taken creative steps, large and small, towards solving many of the problems which affect us, even though they are hidden beneath the oceans. Let this Global Reef Expedition be the rebirth of a great mission to protect our world's undersea treasures.
We decided to embark on this very ambitious Global Reef Expedition, which is essentially a 6-year circumnavigation of the globe. We're filling a gap in research.
Down to Mesa.
And we're also providing very high quality data. And here in the Bahamas, we're accessing remote areas that really have been understudied and never been mapped. The coral reefs are deteriorating in front of our eyes and at a pace that I don't think has ever happened before. And they're like the canary in the coal mine. And as we watch these coral reefs deteriorate, it does not bode well for the overall health of the ocean.
Is what a healthy reef should look like. Just teeming with life. More species live here than in any tropical rainforest, from tiny polyps to large predators. it boggles my mind. The fish that sustain our commercial fisheries rely on the reef for shelter and food. This is a Nassau grouper. They're delicious and traditional food for Bahamians. But sadly, heavy fishing has sent their numbers crashing. A healthy reef can quickly turn into this if you don't manage it properly. Over the past 10 years, I've seen some changes that really worry me. The sea temperature's rising, causing widespread coral bleaching. There's much less diversity than there used to be. High population and development along our coasts produces heavy nutrient runoff. This causes more algae to grow on the reefs. And overfishing throws entire reef systems off balance, making them more susceptible to disease. So it's hardly surprising that over the last two decades, the number of coral diseases has grown exponentially, and there are outbreaks in every tropical ocean.
Right now, the scientists around the world are very, very concerned about the future existence of coral reefs. This is a crisis that we think the coral reefs have never seen before in their 500 million year existence.
And as any Bahamian can tell you, if we lose our reefs, we're in real trouble.
My name is Lindy Knowles. I work for the Bahamas National Trust as an assistant parks planner, and I am indeed a Bahamian. As a tourist nation, we depend heavily on our beautiful seas and our beautiful reefs as a means of food, as a means of protection from storms. We need to conserve the fish, we need to conserve the corals. So in the end, it benefits us all as, for food as well as for beauty.
Our government is trying to do the right thing. It's pledged to protect a fifth of our nearshore marine environment by 2020. But how do we decide which areas are the most important to protect? That's where the Living Oceans Foundation comes in.
This work really is going to help us simply because it functions like a baseline study. It helps us know what we have, so we know where to protect, what to protect, and how to protect it.
The foundation scientists come from around the world. But what's great is they're working in partnership with scientists from the Bahamas, which is how I got to join the expedition.
All right, if I can just have everyone's attention just for a minute, this dive will have the same buddy teams, the same benthic corals and fish teams as we've had in the past few dives. The only difference for this thing, because it's a little deeper than we've been working, we're going to have 55-minute maximum bottom time. That's from the minute you leave the surface of the water till the time you come back up, so that includes your safety stop. All right, everyone, have a great dive.
So here we are, under the sea. This is my idea of paradise. As the scientific team fans out across the reef, each buddy pair has a specific job to do.
The research we conduct on the Global Reef Expedition is really comprised of two parts. The first part is mapping the coral reef resources, and the second part is doing underwater scuba surveys to learn about the marine organisms that live on the reef.
My assignment is to document only the colonies of living coral. I work along a 10-meter transect line, measuring every living coral I find that's more than 4 centimeters across. Then I identify its species and look for any signs of bleaching, disease, or predation. This dead elk horn skeleton is a remnant from the past. It used to be one of the most important reef-building corals in the Bahamas, but disease has killed this patch. Elk horn also suffers badly from bleaching and can be wiped flat by a hurricane. At least this small colony seems healthy. My diving partner is Anessa Lundy, another Bahamian. She's doing a benthic survey.
I basically look at the stuff that grows on the bottom of the seafloor, and I record what that is. If it's coral, I record that. If it's algae, I record it. If it's just rock, I write that down. After that, I use a quadrat and I place it along a transect at every meter. And then I record coral recruits in there. Coral recruits is just young coral after they've settled on the seafloor.
Searching for new recruits is important because it tells us how quickly a reef can regrow after a major disturbance, such as a hurricane or a bleaching event. Hiding under the sand are tiny polyps, less than 2 centimeters big. Young coral can be really hard to see, so on this dive, one of our team is using a specialized mask and an ultraviolet light, which makes the coral's colors stand out more vividly. As with any dive, at some point your air begins to run out, and it's time to return to the surface.
Grand, 1,000.
So basically, a lot of good fish to count.
A lot of variety.
Got a lot of work done.
In between dives, we return to the main ship, the Golden Shadow, to prepare for the next dive site.
Okay, Steve, we just pulled the tenders in now.
There's always work to be done. Living Oceans Foundation fellow scientist, Dr. Sonia Bejarano, is building cages for a crucial piece of research. She wants to know how fast algae grows on different reefs, and if there are enough herbivorous fish around to keep the algae in check.
That's it. So when a disturbance comes, generally, there is a loss of live coral. And in that kind of situation, normally, the algae are quite successful because they grow faster and they're quite good at exploiting any free space that is created in the reef. So we want to know, in these different places that we visit, is there a community of fish that would keep that process under control, that algae blooming under control?
Algae will grow on these tiles made from coral limestone. But to see how fast the algae grows naturally, she's got to keep the fish from eating it.
By being inside these cages, the tiles are being protected from big fish feeding on them, and they are hopefully going to develop a little turf of algae that will allow us to measure how fast algae grow in this reef.
Thank you. Don't worry, these staples are only going into rock, not living coral. And they're temporary. Sonia will remove the cages in 5 days' time. The fish are curious, but they can't get in. It looks like the cages are working. For the second part of the experiment, Sonia sets up several cameras on the reef. These record video of the fish eating.
I'm studying the fish that do the grazing, most of the grazing in the reef, the roving herbivores. And these are in the Caribbean, the parrotfish and the surgeon fish.
Sonia's counting how often the fish bite. Then she'll combine the data with the size of the fish's mouth to calculate how often an area of reef is grazed completely.
What that tells us about the health of the reef or the capacity of the reef to recover is how effective is the community of fish that lives on it, how effective it is at keeping the algae under control in the event of a disturbance.
Sonia's watching these fish the most closely, the parrotfish. If there are lots of these guys around, that's a good thing. But in some places, I have a hard time finding any large ones because they've been overfished. Historically, we Bahamians didn't eat parrotfish. But now that it's harder to find grouper, fishermen are beginning to catch parrotfish instead. That's going to damage the reefs. So at each site we visit, we assess how many fish there are and what kinds of fish. That's Lindy's job.
A great day for diving.
Let's see if we can get some sharks this go around, right? Reef shark, no tigers.
No tigers.
I will be using the reef surveys to determine what's the species richness and diversity of a sample site within about 100 square meters to look at the fish species in the particular area of the reefs that we are assessing. It won't tell us anything about the reef itself, but it will tell us about the fish communities that live on the reef.
There's lots of data to work with. During the Bahamas expedition, we logged more than 1,000 hours of diving. There are all sorts of fish that live on the reefs. We've got French grunts, French angels, rock beauties, queen triggers, four-eyed butterfly fish, and many more. This is a lionfish. It's not welcome here. It's an invasive species from the Indo-Pacific, and it eats everything and anything that comes its way. These, on the other hand, I love. So between the coral surveys and the fish surveys, we collect lots of data about the reefs. But we need to put this information into context. And that's what these guys are up to.
Going down.
Hold it there. All right then, Jeremy. Steady down.
This is Dr. Sam Perkis, and I think his job is the most fascinating of all.
I think it's close.
Hold it there. Up a bit. Hold it there.
He's the one tying all our work together by creating three-dimensional habitat maps. He's using several different techniques.
Down a meter. It's done.
The first is with a tethered video camera that records what the seafloor looks like.
This is also linked in to the laptop and a very accurate GPS, so at any time we know exactly where this camera is as it's recording footage flying along the seabed.
He is also measuring the water depth everywhere the boat goes, all day, every day, 3 times a second.
That's also then related back to the satellite imagery. And the final piece of equipment we have, again, is an acoustic tool. It's a very low-frequency sub-bottom profiler. This is sending a sound wave down through the seabed, and we can start to map out what's going on 50 or 60 meters below the seafloor.
A very accurate GPS unit then links all of these tools together. So satellite imagery is tied to real video footage, to the water depth information, and to what's going on well beneath the seabed. It's pretty incredible.
And by the end of this trip, we're going to be able to produce fantastic three-dimensional maps of the reefs here off Greater Nagua. So at the end of the year, we'll hand over those map products to the Bahamian government, and our hope is that they'll start to use those products to plan the protection of the reefs that they have here, which are some of the best examples surviving in the Bahamas at the moment. So they're very special indeed.
Back in the lab, Sonia Bejarano carefully scrapes off the algae that grew on her tiles. First, she dries it. Then she weighs it. What she discovers is that algae grows faster on reefs that are exposed to more ocean waves. And if too many herbivorous fish are removed from those reefs, then the algae will take over and smother the coral. This is really useful information for someone like me, because now I know which reefs might be most vulnerable to overfishing, and therefore would be good to include in the new marine areas the government wants to protect. So the work of the Living Oceans Foundation is going to provide the Bahamian government with fantastic tools for coral reef preservation in the Bahamas.
I don't want to say to my grandkids, there used to be this really scrumptious fish called the Nassau grouper, and it used to look like this with the stripes. It was so awesome. I don't want to talk in the past tense about the reefs.
What we can do is modify those things we have control over, runoff from the land, treatment of our sewage, better building codes, and just hope and pray and everybody do their small part. And we might make a dent and, well, remove a dent or two, and hopefully it'll recover.
What I've learned on this expedition is that research gives you knowledge. And with that knowledge, we in the Bahamas can make better decisions about how best to manage our valuable resources.
I thank all of you for taking the interest and doing whatever you can do personally and collectively to ensure that our oceans stay healthy for our children and grandchildren.